glove.
What is your background today, Cam?
This is concept art for a nuclear storage facility.
Beautiful.
Very you know impressive. the story behind that though too, Molly, right?
I don't know.
Okay.
It's designed to be foreboding because the thing with nuclear waste is that it lasts for a very, very long time. So the idea with any facility where you would be storing it is that conceptually it might last longer than your civilization, or it might remain dangerous for longer than your civilization stays around to tell people don't dig here. So one of the thought exercises is how do we design a facility that communicates danger to people who don't share our language, or a society that we are discontinuous with. So if you've ever seen the text that reads, "This is not a place of honor, you know, we considered ourselves to be a powerful civilization. Mm-hmm. What is buried here is repulsive to us. No great deed is commemorated here." It was dealing with this idea of like, how do you tell somebody that you don't share a language with that this is not a pyramid where we buried like somebody we revered with a lot of stuff that's made out of solid gold, mm-hmm. right? And also that the stuff that is buried here is not useful as like a weapon to somebody, right? Like,
because you say there's something that's like, there's a lot of great power here, but if you say that, it's like, oh, there's power to be taken and be used against our enemies. It's like, no, mm-hmm. I guess that's not what I want to say.
And if you make it into like a very secure place, that might just be kind of valuable on its own, right? Like maybe it's just now a very valuable fortification.
Even if people are like, they don't know what's in there, but they're like, oh yeah, it's a place that we can occupy and it can keep us safe. And it's like, but maybe not. And there's been a lot of thought about what if you make a place that you just bury completely and you just plant trees on it and you don't let anybody know anything is there?
Mm-hmm.
Well, is that also fair? Because if you completely cover it up, who's to say another species doesn't come along later and dig up that land because they want to use it for something and discover this tomb and they're like, there's something in here. They buried this. They didn't want anyone else to know about it. So you want to try to do something that gives this sense of you need to be very careful. You need to maybe not interact with this unless you are like way smarter than we are.
Yeah, like the one that I really liked was burying it in a desert and creating like a field of tall black obelisks that are just like matte black and absorb all the heat of the sun during the day and are just spaced like, you know, a little ways apart, right? So that you can't quite squeeze between them, and they're just like, you know, you would touch them and be like, ah, oh, that sucked. I don't like doing that. But of course, the best solution is to ensure the continuity of your civilization across the lifespan of all of your waste products. But that's less fun to think about.
Yeah, what's in it for you?
Yeah. And it produces some kind of like interesting suggestions or solutions. Like somebody suggested splicing a gene into cats that would make their fur glow.
Yep.
In areas of high flux, and then you would have to like describe to people that glowing cats are bad and not something that are really cool and that you want
for like your raves.
Mm-hmm. Because yeah. If I saw a glowing cat, I would immediately want it.
Yeah, you'd follow it to until like the more it was glowing, the better. Is the audience for this design like future sort of post-modern civilization, post-postmodern, I guess, or like other off-planet species?
It could be anything, right? Like presumably, like over the plutonium has like a 90-year half-life. Uranium, like nuclear fuel uranium, has several tens of thousands of years. So like that's unlikely to be, you know, if human civilization was to end tomorrow, right? It would probably take much longer than that for the crows or the octopodes, right? To kind of like build cities and take over. So it's probably for the next humans.
Is that the assumption that a species would build their own cities? I always assume they would just occupy our remnants.
I mean, that's another interesting thing to think about, right?
Yeah.
Like, is it the world without us?
Flood. Yeah. Yeah.
Where, like, the longest lasting artifacts of our civilizations will be our bronze statues. But, like,
a lot of our buildings won't last more than a few hundred years, though.
Yeah, well, like, they, like, skyscrapers and things, right?
Yeah.
Like, a lot of our infrastructure requires constant maintenance. Right, like, I've lived in places where you had to go and shovel your roof off in the winter because otherwise your house would disintegrate.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, that's 1 year. But yeah, over a couple thousand years, I don't really remember what they predicted to last a long time. But it's one of those I think it's much more of an interesting thought exercise than it is like an actual engineering problem, or a communication problem.
Mm-hmm.
But you know that there are people working on it.
Because I think there was a CFB, like an animated short, right, about aliens who come upon the Earth and observe and conclude that cars are the dominant species.
I remember that. It was Canadian Film Board where they because I remember there were cars going along an assembly line and there was just like a cascade of like precious gems that they were passing through to get covered in like all the bling. It was kind of like the frosting cascade at a Dunkin' Donut, or not a Dunkin' Donuts,
Krispy Kreme.
A Krispy Kreme.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, and I remember they were like, we don't know, there are these little sort of parasite creatures that crawl in and out of them and, you know, clean them and stuff. Those must be the servant species. And we don't know what happens to cars when they die, but here's what we think. And then it was like a sort of, you know, powerhouse kind of factory style of like it getting sort of smushed with a big hammer and then some pink thing being ejected and that they refurbished and then put back in another car.
Hmm. Yeah, wow. I need to go back and like, there was a Canadian Film Board app that was basically just the log driver's waltz button.
Yeah.
The National Film Board of Canada does have like they have an Apple TV app now. They have, I think all the other apps are really quite, like they work quite well. They even had like somebody made an app that interfaces to their website for Kodi. So if you have like a Kodi box at home, you can install that app and you can get access to all the NFB stuff. So there's a lot more on their website that's just freely available